Okay, thank you. So I'll talk now about freemium. I will focus on that particular economic model for open access publishing. And just to begin, I just want to make you notice that in the last few months, the landscape of open access changed drastically from activism to policy, or we could say from Steven Arnott to Nelly Cruz. So it's a big change with David Willett in the middle. And one consequence of this drastic change of landscape for open access is that the focus in this area shifted from the green model of open access to the gold model. So now we have what we could call the gold rush. It means that we have this market getting bigger and bigger with more and more money going to the gold model of open access publishing. And more money is promised also to publish in the gold way of open access. But as you know, every gold rush has its drawback, and sometimes the gold rush leave behind them what we could call ghost towns. I noticed that everybody was talking about their holidays, so I take the chance to talk about my holidays. I was at Body Town in United States this summer, and it's a famous ghost town left by a gold rush too. So my real question about the gold model for open access is this a sustainable model in the long term? Because now we have a lot of money, but the publishing in this model relies on only one source of funding. And that's I think that maybe it's dangerous because maybe one day this source will dry up and we will have problems. So between the different difficulties with the gold model of open access, I just want to point out one of them. And this problem, I sum it up with the proverb, "Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater." What is the bathwater in this proverb? The bathwater is the old, clumsy, restricted access publishing system that prevents readers to access to information. So this morning we had readers saying, young researchers saying, "I'm frustrated because I can't access to information." That's the bathwater that we want to throw away. But what is the baby now? I'm afraid that the baby could be the reader itself, or to be more precise, the reader's need. How we can serve the specific needs of the reader. Because in the session this morning, we had a second young researcher saying, "I'm frustrated because I'm information overloaded." So who's taking care of my special needs to have the right information I need and to get it very quickly without being drowned by the information overload? And that's the problem. So now I want you to compare with me the two publishing systems. In the traditional model, of course, it's clumsy, we know that. But there is something interesting. And the thing interesting in the traditional model is that you have feedback between the user, the reader, and the publisher through the sales. So when you have publication, the publisher is pushed to publish good books that find their readers because it gives more usage. And when you have more usage, you have more sales. And when you have more sales, you have more income and you can publish more books, provided the shareholders don't eat everything in the middle. But that's another problem. When you see the gold model now, the problem is that you don't have anymore this feedback between the reader and the publisher, because you have the funding, the income, that gives money for the publication. And after that, you have the usage. And we know that the impact is boosted by open access, but the usage, the reading usage, is a dead end in the system. And you don't have this economic feedback to the publisher to encourage him to publish well-read books. So we have this problem of comparison between between the two models. So now we are, I think, at the heart of the subject in this session is how to make open pay. For many years, I was struck by the citation from Stuart Brandt that everybody knows and that nobody knows. Everybody knows information wants to be free. That's the motto that is circulating on the internet. But few people know the whole citation of Stuart Brandt in the 1984 Hacker Conference. I read it with you. On the one hand, information wants to be expensive because it's so valuable. The right information in the right place just changed your life. But on the other hand, information wants to be free because the cost of getting it out is getting lower and lower at the time. So you have this fighting between each other. And I think we are exactly at the heart of the subject. And when you think about it 2 minutes, you think that the freemium model is the implementation of this citation. It's exactly the practical model that works on that contradiction between the necessity to have open access to information, to have information free, and to have premium services delivered to the right person in the right place at the right moment. So it's exactly the point. For the record, the freemium term is attributed to Fred Wilson in a blog post on his blog in 2006. So in his blog, he made an entry, he wrote an entry, published an entry named My Favorite Business Model, where he described the freemium model saying, okay, we have many examples of freemium model on the net. We have Skype, we have Flickr, Trillion, NewsGetter, Box.net, and we can add now Dropbox and many services. What name can we give to that model? And in fact, it's not Fred Wilson who invented the name. It's a commentator. So you can see this person at the bottom of the slide saying, okay, it's free plus premium, so we can make this word, this portmanteau word, freemium. And you can see that there was another commentator, two comments before, who said, okay, we can say it's the crack dealer model. But I don't know why nobody took that that name. So, okay. So if we get back now and we focus to areas more closer to us, we can see that, for example, in the press, we have more and more titles using the freemium model because for them and for the delivery of digital content, it's the only way to survive and to build a sustainable economic model. So we have the New York Times, we have Le Monde. And I think that Wired magazine is one of the best examples in the press because it's very successful and they do it very cleverly. But of course, in our sector, and for us, Open Edition, the organization I belong to, OECD was the best example of freemium policy for publication, and it was a model for us. We can know, I put there, you can recognize him, Cory Doctorow, because we can think that Cory Doctorow, as an author, developed its own freemium model, because you know that he put its novels open access on its website, on its blog. And in the same time, the novels are sold in print format or digital format by traditional publishers. So it's a freemium too. And now I can talk to you a few minutes about our own example. So I belong to an organization, public organization named Open Edition. And we built a platform last year named Open Edition Books, where we propose to publishers to disseminate in humanities and social sciences to disseminate part of their collections in the freemium mode, so open access with the licensing of premium services. So I can show you that, for example, each publisher, here we have the example of Central European University Press, has its own space inside the platform. Here you are in an HTML browser. And you see that, for example, here you have chapter by chapter the books which are open access in HTML. And HTML is the perfect format. We talked a little bit about formats, but HTML is the perfect format for open access because it's the lightest, the most accessible, the most universal. It's a standard. So for us, HTML is the best format for that. But you can see on the right-hand side of the slide that you have other formats. But those formats are not accessible open access. They are sold to libraries and to individual readers. So that's here the point. We generate also, we produce also for each book an HTML version in open access, but a PDF version in restricted access, an EPUB version in restricted access, an Amazon version for the Kindle and so on, and they are sold. And that is a part of our premium services that generate incomes mainly for the publishers. So here we have an example of a platform combining open access and licensing of premium services that generate commercial incomes for the publishers. The publication in open access is great because, as we all know, open access publishing maximizes visibility and impact of publication of the books. And that's great. The HTML version in open access is great for us because we can work on it, developing features that enhance this visibility and, for example, the viral dissemination of the books. For example, we developed an embed version of the HTML version of the books. So here, for example, I embedded on my own website, I embedded a chapter from a book. So this viral dissemination is enhanced. And that helps us build a place of attention because, as you know, we are in an attention economy. So the main point is to focus and concentrate attention on platforms. So what we are doing, and we need open access to do that, with now more than 30 million visits a year on all our platforms. But on the other side, on the other hand, I should say Stuart Brandt, we develop premium services, and we develop mainly premium services for libraries and for their patrons. So here's the list of the premium services that we license to libraries for money and that generate incomes for the publishers. I don't go into details of these services because they will change, and that's the main point. For the moment, we propose these services for libraries. But in 2 years or 5 years and 10 years, it will be completely different because their needs and the needs of the readers will surely be completely different. But now that we have a business model and now that we have a commercial relationships with them, we have the possibility and the incentive to work on that and to develop the services that are fit to their special needs and to change, and even if that need change. So for the moment, the PDF is premium because the readers want the PDF. But in 10 years, they probably won't want the PDF. Or maybe I'm wrong, but that's not a problem. For the moment, the EPUB is just going up. But maybe in 10 years, there will be another format. So we can adapt, and we have the incentives and the economic incentive to adapt to the special needs of the baby, the reader. Okay? Okay, that's very difficult to make. It's very technical, it's very commercial too, and it's a big organization to put that put that alive. Why? Because as you understand, the freemium model lay on lay on different formats. So for each book, you have to deliver, and Francis said that, you have to deliver the book in print, in HTML, in PDF, in EPUB, in Amazon format, and maybe new format in the next years. So it's very technical. And we, as we are working in humanities and social sciences, we are working with publishers, which are, for most of them, small, and they don't have much money to do all that work. So that's why we developed a special program to do that for them. And we had a special grant, public money, to help publishers digitize and encode in XML their catalog and disseminate their books through their platforms into these different formats. Okay, so here we are now. We have this program into our platform, Open Edition Freemium Program. We developed it 1 year ago or 2 years ago for journals, and now we have 100 journals in the freemium mode. So it's exactly the same that for the books. HTML, open access, and the premium formats are licensed. We have now more than 800 freemium books on our platform, and we have the grants to the funds to have 16,000 in 2020. We have more than 60 subscribing libraries in 2 years. We began 1 year ago. And the share of the income is 66% for publishers, and we retain 33%. Not for our shareholders, because we don't have shareholders as we are public, but to reinvest, as I said, all the money, so 100%, to develop new service for the readers. Okay, a conclusion now. 3 years ago, I was struck by this citation from the CEO of Dropbox during the freemium conference. It was published on the blog. And he said about the freemium model, you know, it's a numbers game, so bust out your Excel spreadsheet. It's all about finding things in the margins, lots of little things rather than one key thing. And it's very important for me because it's the key citation for me to explain how we can build, for books especially, sustainable economic model. So now, to develop sustainable economic model for book publishing, I think that the key word is diversification. I don't know if it's good in English, diversification. Is it okay? Okay. So for book publishing, what we need is, of course, we need funding in the gold mode, but not only this source of funding. We need also commercial revenues from the reading usage, and that's part of the freemium model. We need maybe also crowdfunding system like Kickstarter in other possibilities. There is Unglowit also. We need different type of revenues, and we need public support also to have this sound and sustainable economic model developing in open access. And in fact, open access publication help the development of all these revenues. So it's a good circle, a positive feedback loop to this model. Thank you very much.